How did we find ourselves in this big tech dystopia, this world of opposition, constant conflict, our very attention, our awareness turned into a product mined by big business? In this conversation with Tristan Harris on my podcast, Under the Skin, available from Luminary, you can get it on Apple, we talked in depth about how we've arrived at a point where our attention, our free will, the essence of who we are, has been turned into a product by the most powerful businesses in the world. Have a look.
Yeah, I'm so glad you're bringing this up. I think the film is very clear. At the end of the film, when Justin Rosenstein, who's the inventor of the like button, says, this is the product of a runaway economic logic. And he says very clearly, so long as a whale is worth more dead than alive, and a tree is worth more as a bunch of 2x4s than as a tree, now we are the whale, we are the tree. Our mind is the very thing that's being strip mined for profit. In fact, if you want to extend the metaphor, we started running out of attention to monetize. So we actually figured out how to double or triple the size of the attention economy by getting you to focus on two or three screens at once, because then now you're multitasking. And so we're selling thinner and thinner slices of attention. We're fracking for that attention. And it's that runaway extractive model that, for the first time, as he says in the film, maybe this will be the thing that helps us wake up from the fact that this logic is unsustainable. Now, when you say that, it doesn't mean, hey, let's switch to socialism. It says, hey, there's a logic that if we're the product, which is the whole point of the film, that when you're not the customer, but you're the product, when your mind is the very thing that is being strip mined for extraction, for resourcing, we are worth more when our free will or consciousness is turned not into 2x4s, but dead slabs of human behavior. Predictable human behavior, because the premise of surveillance capitalism is that the technology has to get better and better and better at predicting your next move. As Yuval Harari, my friend, would say, when technology knows our weaknesses better than we know ourselves. And if you view that as a trend line, technology is getting better and better and better at knowing your weaknesses, whether here's that thing that'll make you hate the other side more because it's, you know, you're on one side of the political aisle and we know exactly what kind of political red meat to throw in front of you, but now it's sort of AI generated political lab created red meat, because we can actually generate the kinds of things that'll perfectly stimulate your amygdala. Or in the case of a teenager saying, hey, this is the kind of dosing schedule of social validation, that if we give you 2 likes now, but we hold some back and then we give you 20 likes later, or TikTok competing with Instagram will essentially compete on how much social validation and approval, how much attention can we give you compared to Instagram. So literally, this is how TikTok stole users from Instagram, is for a same video you'd post on Instagram, maybe on average on Instagram, you get, you know, 1,000 views, 100 likes and 10 comments. If TikTok can say, well, if you post to one of these hashtags, you'll get 100,000 views and 100 comments and, you know, many more likes. And so they're competing to hijack our nervous system, to hijack our deepest psychological needs. And as you said, it's not just hey, there's these evil design decisions. I don't think anyone intended for this to happen. It's a game theory of, if I don't do it, the other guy will. So if YouTube starts auto-playing videos 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and Netflix doesn't do that, and Facebook doesn't follow along and say, here's the up next 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 auto countdown, here's the next thing, everyone is competing in this race to the bottom of the brainstem. But it's a race to the back door to the human soul.
You're very good communicator, mate. Your analogies are spot on. Like a lot of these metaphors, you can really chase down right to the, I didn't think you'd get as far as dead slabs of wood of human attention with the whale or deforestation metaphor. That's incredibly skillful use of language. Just for a moment, I see, you know, obviously you're a really highly educated person. Where's that bit of it come from?
I'm actually really glad you're bringing this up. I think that these issues are really abstract. You know, when you think about climate change, or, you know, our economic paradigm, or deforestation, or how technology is affecting society, each one of those are hyper objects, meaning the philosopher Timothy Morton, the complexity of those effects is far greater than sort of a simple mind can see. Like, where is climate change? Show me the atoms of climate change. Can I see them? Can I smell them? Can I touch them? No, I have to know about an abstract system, unless I talk to the people studying coral reefs, you know, in Australia, or talk to the people studying the glaciers in Iceland or in Greenland, or talk to the people studying species loss in the Amazon. So, but our analogy here is that this is like the climate change of culture. Because just like there were, you know, if you didn't have the people who are studying species loss in the Amazon, loss of insects, you know, half the insect mass going down, the melting glaciers, coral reefs, we have it, those seem like different disconnected effects, unless you have a unified model of what climate change is, unless you have a language, oh, emissions cause this sort of set of cascading effects that are all dependent on each other. And similarly with technology, we have a climate change of culture. We have shortening of attention spans. We have a hyper-focusing on the present instead of the future or the past of history. We have more isolation and addiction because business models that profit from keeping you scrolling by yourself are more profitable than business models that get you out with your friends in community or at church or out with, you know, sewing clubs or book clubs. We have more conspiracy thinking, more polarization, more extremism, and a breakdown of truth. And those are not disconnected effects. Shortening attention spans, polarization, teen mental health, those are all part of a connected system that is that extractive logic that is causing all of them. So to answer your question about language, we focus a lot on language because if you don't have clear things that everyone can understand, then we can't change the system. So we have to make it accessible for everyone. And I've studied things like neurolinguistic programming and Russell conjugation and been fascinated by the power of language over our minds. In fact, that's actually one of the things that got me into this, was really seeing how, you know, if you, using the right language can actually help people see something that they can't see, especially using kinetic language, saying things like the blast radius of an idea is more powerful than saying the impact of an idea. Anyway, we could get into all these topics. I don't know if you know the work of George Lakoff, who's a political linguist theory. He talks about the ways that metaphors are embedded in all of our language. One of my favorite examples, the nation as a family. We don't send our sons and daughters to war. We don't want those missiles in our backyard. And our founding fathers told us, right? So embedded within even the concept of a nation is the kind of construction of the nation as a family. And these are the invisible ways throughout all political language that we're affected. If you say to people there's going to be a lockdown, suddenly you get half the country rebelling against that because, hey, that's gonna kill small business owners. But if you say, let's do shelter in place, that's much more politically appetizable. And people like Frank Luntz and George Lakoff and many others have focused on the power of language for a long time.
Well, if you enjoyed that conversation, please leave your comment below. The algorithm will certainly appreciate it. And please subscribe to this channel or my awakening channel so you can learn to meditate and free yourself from some of this madness. If you want to pay for a product where they don't observe you, sign up to my podcast on Luminary. If you don't pay for the product, you are the product. There is a small subscription fee, but you get a great conversation like that one every week, plus a guided meditation from me. If you enjoyed this video, have a look at this one. It's a very good video in a similar kind of area. You'll learn more on this subject. And if you just want to meditate now and chill or do some breath exercise, have a look at this one over on my Awakening channel. Please subscribe to my channel and please sign up to my mailing list on russellbrand.com. Cheers.